So, no, it's not something spectacular to out-debate a student. You'll find that these people, they get discouraged. These people who do this because nobody listens to them. One guy who invented the sin survey, Brother Grohl probably knows who I'm talking about. He started the sin survey, so if you did the sin survey, he's the originator. After a few years of preaching, he had no converts. Not one person got saved in his ministry. And so he concluded, here's his exact words, I conclude that God, the moral governor of the universe, is not doing his fair share to see that sinners get saved. And he quit preaching. Hasn't preached since, and has been backslid ever since then. No, you cannot get to their heart through their mind. He says, when I started preaching for about five years after, I sincerely thought that this was the way to preach. The more I pray, the more I want to reach out to students. Brother Michael already preached about this morning, about false compassion for sinners. You see them crying and you want to tell them that God loves them and have compassion. Well, I thought of that. I wrote down Michael Vigna, false compassion right there. Yes, now he wants to reach out to students. As if he was not reaching out to students prior to this. As if he was not preaching God's word in the first place. Now he has, he's cloaked himself. Some have gone away, cloaking themselves up in intellectualism. Now this guy has cloaked himself up in false compassion. He now is caring for the students and cares for their souls. And really wants to see them saved. Well, my question is, you mean you weren't wanting to reach out to students before? Why weren't you? No, that's not my fault, it's your fault. For the last year, I've been looking over my success as a preacher. Bingo. This guy's had no converts either. He's seen nobody get saved. There's a problem. Yes, I'm sure after years of preaching, if you have nobody get saved in your ministry, the devil would play with your mind and your heart and say, you're doing it all wrong. There's a better way. But my question is, okay, what's your alternative? Go do it. I was fortunate. Back in the 80s, I stopped counting at 300 souls I'd led to the Lord personally on college campuses. I stopped counting years ago before I ever got married on that. And the campus ministry as a whole. So I wrote back and I said, as far as I know, you don't even really associate with anybody in the campus ministry, and you don't have much to do with them, and you wouldn't be in a position of knowing what's going on as a whole of the campus preachers out there. He says, I don't have people in churches come up to me and say I was saved under so-and-so campus preacher. Well, I don't have people come up to me and say I was saved under so-and-so evangelist. Hi, I'm Jim Gilles. I was saved up underneath Pastor so-and-so. It don't happen like that. You see how the devil's playing this guy's mind? Tell the devil, these are real temptations. Every preacher goes through this. You have to overcome this, get through this, and not let the devil just play on you all the time. No.
Whatever happened to a sense of duty and doing this for the glory of God?
Yes.
Period.
Exactly. And I agree. You're doing it for God's glory, not so much for yours, so you can say that they were saved underneath your ministry. You're not doing it for that. And so, I wrote back and said, well, I can give you names and phone numbers of people who've been saved in my ministry. Would that change your mind? Is that the ultimate authority or bibliosity? Is having people saved in your ministry? Of course, that's our objective. But does that mean that the Bible's wrong? You stop using the word whore, sodomite, and pervert, Bible terms? Because, this guy is in a state of confusion and is pretty well unreachable because he's isolated himself and doesn't want anybody to tell him what he's doing is wrong, or he's in a dire strait situation.
Except people that don't teach.
Yes, except people who would agree with him. Exactly. I have seen people cry, but where is the real fruit? Well, that should be a question he should be asking himself. He's obviously looking in the mirror, doesn't like what he sees, and he's trying to transpose somebody else's image in there, like us. He's trying to blame us instead of himself. The mirror doesn't ever change. And so I personally like the feeling, the way I've been, I personally feel like the way we've been preaching, number one, isn't biblical. So, all right. You never see anyone in the Bible preach without real, genuine compassion. Yes. So, he's now trying to shoot at us and say we're not compassionate, we're not biblical, because we don't have compassion for sinners. Don't worry about Revelation 14, 3:19. If you have real love, you'll rebuke and chasten them. Yeah, that, you know, Bible doesn't matter anymore. This is what happens when you throw the Bible out and you claim that it's not biblical. The Bible is not biblical anymore, but you are now more biblical than the Bible, but yet you're left with nothing. You're left with nothing. He has nothing to present to anybody. And so, you never... So I wrote back and said, are you speaking for yourself or for others? You know, what are you doing here? Are you saying that every preacher that you know does not have true, genuine compassion? Or maybe just you have not and do not have real, genuine compassion? And so, then he says, it isn't logical telling them their destiny without emphasizing how they can change it. Now this guy is accusing us of not preaching the gospel. Telling people how they... Now, is this not what you hear from Campus Crusade for Christ people? And these wimp, milquetoast Christians? And this guy, he was one of us. I wrote back and said, hey, are you alleging this about us or just yourself? You know, he's confusing. He's trying to transpose his guilt upon everybody else. You know, maybe he was just a clone. I don't know. Maybe he never had it in his heart, never studied it, never prayed much in his heart. I mean, this man is a totally confused individual. He is confused. He's going through a total paradigm shift. He says, I have never been anointed while preaching about homos. So I said, what is the anointing? How would you know if you are anointed or not? I'm being a little sarcastic here. The anointing to some is a goosebumpy feeling.
That's right.
You know, where you start shouting, right, jumping up and down, and having you have your two cult wave over the aisle, and they all fall down.
Right.
All the Tom Bentley and Billy Hinn garbage.
That's the anointing.
Yeah, that's the anointing. You're and good. I've never seen it work bringing someone to Christ. Bingo. He's had no converts. So the devil's playing on his mind, having to question the entire Bible. It works good at getting crowds. All of us can do that. Well, no, not everybody can do that. But who can get them saved and established in church? Well, I've gotten quite a few. Some are pastors now, personally myself. Some are evangelists. This guy has none. So he's trying to transpose his failure upon everybody else. Then he says, I love y'all and want y'all to tell me what you think. Either I've lost my mind, fell off the bandwagon, or do I have something here? Yes, you have something here, but what you have, we don't know. And so, yes, the rise and fall of a campus preacher. It happens, Brother Bro. As had many, he had a good group of preachers up in Penn State back in the 70s and 80s. We've seen them come and go. You've probably seen them come and go already. And it's sad, but they all had the same excuses, the same scenario. They try to blame us, blame the Bible, and really it's their own fault. And they have failed somewhere after reading this and knowing what the Bible says. This guy has not talked to God for years. This guy does not have a personal relationship with God. He does not know the God of the Bible or the Bible. And he's lost contact.